What got you hooked on rock and roll initially? Was it a particular album? Was it a first concert? Was it your parents' record collection? What?
First, it was, well, I liked the radio, and I got really, really into listening to the radio by myself when I was maybe 9 or 10. So, and it was like KZY in Southern California. So it was like basically top 40 AM. So it's like, you know, Seasons in the Sun.
I can relate to
heartbeat,
that.
Heartbeat, it's a love beat.
South Texas.
And I'm just waiting for my favorite songs to come on. And I really like that weird stuff. Okay. So my thing was I liked weird stuff. So I listened to Dr. Demento. And the first records that I ever got, I got them because they were funny. Because I'm a little kid and I'm in for the gags, man. So I heard of Frank Zappa like really early. And I liked the Beatles because they were funny. Like they made me laugh. And so the music kind of came in after for me. It was more about jokes and just like being silly. And so that kind of shaped my thing. But really, once I had a friend in fourth grade, once we're 10 and we're in fourth grade, and I have a friend who has an older brother who has a record collection. And his record collection consisted mainly of prog music. Yes, Emerson, Lake and Palmer, Pink Floyd, Frank Zappa. And I got really into it. And I was already studying music. So I was already a little classical piano dude. Okay. So that made me like go, hey, this is what I do. I've been trained somewhat to do this stuff. And then the Beatles. After I discovered them, it was like all the way. I knew every song and every word by the Beatles by the time I was 13 years old, I'm sure of it. But then how do you get in a band was the thing. How do you become in a band? And I was about 14 and I didn't have any. I had an acoustic guitar at home and I had my parents' piano. And I had a trumpet because I was in the elementary school band and junior high band. So 14, I'm seventh grade, eighth grade. And my friend has an older brother who has a band and they're all seniors and I'm a freshman. Okay. And we did school to go watch them practice. And they said they were looking for a bass player. And I lied and said I was a bass player and I didn't know. I never even touch the bass, and they like give me the bass, and there's a bass, and it's a Gibson EB-O. Ooh, and it's like an SG, it's a bitchin' bass, right? Wow. And I have photos of this stuff, and I post it occasionally on my Facebook, but it's me, and they used to call me Space Monkey, and I had long hair, and I was a tiny little guy with a giant bass, and I played with a pick, and we played Jumpin' Jack Flash. We played Breaking the Law because that wasn't even out yet, but we played Born to Be Wild, and we played Stones, you know, we played Creedence, played shit like that. And then we played God Save the Queen by the Sex Pistols.
Yeah.
And this is literally summer of 78. So the record is like a current record. And there's a guy in our band. So no one knows how to be punk yet. They have no idea. We all had long hair, except we had this guy in our band who was into like, you know, glitter rock and the Sweet. And he was into like, you know, Alice Cooper. And later he was in a band called Cooper Mania. This guy, Jeff Colgan, he wore his girlfriend's pants and he had long bleach blonde hair with bangs and that stuck up. And his hair stuck up on the top and it went down like that. And it looked like he could have been in Sweet, right?
Yeah.
And, or Alice Cooper band.
I think they call like that like a Priscilla.
Yeah. It was like a full on
Priscilla. Yeah. like a
beehive. I spent the next 5 years trying to figure out how to make my hair do that. And I would ruin my hair constantly. I'd grow my hair and ruin it. And have to cut it. Like, it was a nightmare. So finally I just gave up and I'm like, hey, punk. So we just cut off the hair. No worry about that. And it was still this hard music. And you know what? I thought I was into that, you know, I was totally into whatever was fresh and new. But by the time that all my friends down the street stopped beating me up and started being punk themselves, I was on to something new. I started getting into like more of an Americana thing, and I was into like Los Lobos and the Blasters and the Stray Cats, and I started getting into more country and more just stuff that I felt I could actually play, you know, and write, and and then I had a big break of not doing anything because I was all fucked up on drugs. So by the time I was like 19 till I was 23, I had a really bad drug problem. And so I got cleaned up. And then next thing I knew, music was the thing. It was like the full force that kept me like going. And it really stuck a fire under my ass so hard. And I knew I never wanted to, you know, get to where I was again, you know, like that. And so I started playing, and I ended up being in a band with Jack Grisham from TSOL. And it was a more metal kind of band called Tender Fury. And we had a deal with some record company and looking for management. And we did a bunch of shows, and it was really fun. It was like a metal band. So we would play at the Cat House, or we'd play at the Roxy, and we'd play at, so we play with bands like Bang Tango and Motorcycle Boy and Junkyard. They were part of that scene too. And
I remember one time, not to like jump in here and mess up your, okay. That was all awesome. That was awesome story.
It's like you never would know that about me.
I remember you telling me upon one of our earliest meetings that you were, this is, I recall this sentence coming out of your brain. You said, yeah, I was out the toys, you know, when all that was going on, I was out there. I was doing that when you were doing it, I was doing the same thing. I remember you
all
saying
the girls
that.
I liked were into that scene. They were going to Hollywood. They were all about the cult. They were all about, the Guns N' Roses thing was about to like blow up when I got clean. And it did that whole time. 88 was, you know, KNAC was playing Appetite.
Yeah.
And it took months. I remember because the radio would play them all the time and still nothing. It just, the ice wouldn't break. And then finally, and they were just the biggest thing in the world.
Yeah.
And, you know, another 2 years of that. And then the next biggest thing in the world came, Nirvana came.
Right.
And then, you know, so then everything became Lollapalooza and everything became alternative rock and modern rock radio. And so that's why, you know, when Dave says we got number one record on the American charts, he's right in a way, but the fact is it wasn't the top 100. It wasn't the pop charts. It wasn't the rock charts. It was the modern rock charts. But by 1998, the modern rock chart was all that mattered.
Right.
For about 5 years. That's all anybody cared about.
Wow.
And it's because of Nirvana, and then it's because of Green Day, and then it's because of Rancid, and,
right?
You know, and that's just the way things went. And then PJ Harvey, and then the Pixies, and then next thing you know, Smashing Pumpkins, and you got this whole alt nation, and then you know, and things, and all that stuff's gone. It's all gone. Everything's gone.
Yeah.
And everything we do now is just us doing what we've always loved to do, and we do it. And dude, I gotta say one more time, the Igniter record, that's my jam. That is the sound that I was telling you, my aesthetic got kind of stuck around 78, 79, you know, and you like nailed almost all the biggies of that time.
I to interject your sort of, I call it a review of the record, the Golden Age of Black Magic, reviewed by Tony Scalzo.
Oh, yeah.
Fastball. You weren't trying.
I was on a couple cups of coffee.
Yeah, you were not reviewing the record, but you were reviewing the record.
Yeah.
I turned it into a review and reposted it and shared it with the band,
Igniter,
and their minds were blown. They were just like, what? And I'm like, yeah. Did you see the photo surface of you hanging out with your bros wearing the Igniter cap? It ended up on the Pat Igniter, like, found the photo of you wearing the Igniter hat.
Yeah, I was wearing it in the studio, actually, when we were at the studio just a couple of weeks.
Had to have been what it was, and it was. Yeah. It Pat saw it online somewhere.
Thanks for the hat, by the way.
No problem. Reposted it somewhere on the Igniter Facebook or something.
Good deal. Like, that's what it's all about. And I want to promote the Leche House too, down in Buda.
Nice.
So Martinez from Brownout.
Oh, okay.
And also, he's a huge hard rock. He's got a bunch of, you know, Brownout posters and a group of Phantasma stuff. But he's also got a giant Slayer poster on the wall too. And so, and you know, they had the Brown Sabbath thing, that project.
Yes.
Where they did I think they did the whole Paranoid album. Wow. But they did like Spanish, Espanol, it was badass.
Do they? I haven't actually heard that. Are they doing it like Latin rock style, or are they doing it Sabbath style?
Yeah, but with pretty killer rock guitar.
Good.
And so it's kind of like a hybrid.
Yeah.
And that was about 4 or 5 years ago.
Yeah, I've seen some of at School of Rock, there was more than one kid show up with a Brown Sabbath t-shirt. And I'm like,
what? Yeah, that's cool, right? Yeah.
You see like a 12-year-old walk up wearing a Brown Sabbath t-shirt. Do you even know what that is? Do you know what that's a play on? You know,
it's an amazing thing. I mean, I love projects like that, and I think people should do more crazy shit like that.
Well, now that we know, like, your earliest beginnings, you were looking for funny stuff, and Dr. Demento said, you know, that makes a lot of sense.
Watch out where the Huskies go, man. You know?
Well,
I remember having some of that stuff on cassette tape, Disco Duck and all that stuff around the same time frame.
I love novelty records, yeah.